9/11, the Berlin Wall falling, the loss of the Space Shuttle Challenger, hearing that John Lennon had died. History is full of moments that imprint themselves on our brains, letting us recall details years and decades later regarding the question, where were you when? For many, especially the baby boomer generation, that moment was the assassination of John Fitzgerald Kennedy. I'm your host, David, and this week we are going to start taking a look at some of the cultural impacts that JFK's death prompted. This is the Cold War. November 22nd, 1963 is a day that is well fixed in the memories of hundreds of millions of people around the world. On that day, while riding in an open motorcade through Dealey Plaza in Dallas, Texas, the 35th President of the United States was shot and killed. The assassin was Lee Harvey Oswald, a former US Marine and returned defector from the Soviet Union. Oswald was arrested shortly after the shooting, but was himself shot and killed 2 days later by a nightclub operator named Jack Ruby. A 10-month investigation, the Warren Commission, followed the shootings and concluded that there was no conspiracy and each man was operating alone. Now, the JFK assassination and the Warren Commission have produced no end of conspiracies, with responsibility being attributed to a myriad of different organizations, from the KGB to Castro and the Cubans, to the CIA, to the Mafia, to Bigfoot, to the saucer people, and even the reverse vampires. Conspiracy is something that historian Catherine Olmsted has written about extensively, including the rise of citizen sleuths in her 2011 article, The Truth Is Out There. Deep suspicions about the government and their competency, which would only increase from 1963 on out, with many other fiascos like Watergate and Iran-Contra further fueling the fire of distrust. But that isn't what we're here to talk about today, although we are going to come back to the theme of conspiracy and cover-up with regards to JFK in a later episode, with a focus on the impacts that they have produced through the Cold War and beyond. Instead, I want to talk about how JFK's death impacted American culture, the ripple effect it had on how media was consumed, for example. It also gives me a chance to talk about the Beatles. What got me thinking about this, by the way, was a theory I saw postulating that the shooting in Dealey Plaza was the event that allowed the Beatles to storm America only a few months after JFK's death. The assassination of the president that November shocked the United States and the world. In the United States, citizens reeled from the first presidential assassination in 62 years, flags were lowered to half-mast around the world, and even Soviet Premier Khrushchev wrote to President Johnson that the gravity of this loss is felt by the whole world, including the Soviet Union. The assassination of Kennedy impacted American and international politics, as well as the way that Americans perceived the presidency. It became a defining moment for a generation. Journalist Bob Schieffer has called it the weekend that changed America. And for me, one of the most interesting theories connected to the JFK assassination has nothing to do with grassy knolls or the Soviet or American government, instead focusing on the assassination as a major turning point in the narrative for America and the genre of rock and roll, specifically the popularity of the Beatles. This has been recently summarized by Professor Jack Hamilton, who postulates that the popularity of the Fab Four in America was directly tied to the assassination of President Kennedy. The Beatles arrived in America in February of 1964 and, quote, soothed an injured nation in the wake of the assassination and saved rock and roll in the process. This is an idea that has echoes in Dr. Richard Aquila's recent book, Rock and Roll in Kennedy's America, although Aquila largely argues that American rock and roll hardly needed saving. The problem with the claim put forward by Hamilton is that rock and roll wasn't in need of saving in 1964. Motown Records had an impressive lineup of musicians, with enduring names like Martha and the Vandellas, Marvin Gaye, and Stevie Wonder all having major hits. The summer of 1963 saw Johnny Cash and Columbia Records release Ring of Fire, the Beach Boys and Capitol Records were chart-topping with Surfin' USA, Leslie Gore's It's My Party was topping charts alongside The Angels' My Boyfriend's Back, and James Brown, Live at the Apollo, became the best-selling album of 1963 based on worldwide sales. To say the Beatles saved rock and roll is to ignore the many charting and rising stars of music that were already rocking the airwaves before the Beatles stepped foot on American soil or the set of The Ed Sullivan Show. Greil Marcus, who wrote the Beatles entry in the Rolling Stone Illustrated History, told one journalist that, quote, "I can say that for me, there was never at the time any connection between the malaise or shock over the assassination and the arrival of the Beatles," end quote. The most connection that can be drawn is that coincidentally with the Beatles was released on November 22, 1963, the same day as the assassination. But as far as British Beatles historian Mark Lewison, the author of The Beatles All These Years, knows, there was no connection made between anyone in Britain, where the height of British Beatlemania was ongoing, between the record's release and the assassination. In America, the band was already getting recognition to some degree before November 22nd of 1963. Ed Sullivan had in fact already booked the group to be on his show, and Time magazine had already profiled the band and their fans in their November 15th, 1963 edition. On the 18th of November, NBC's Huntley Brinkley Report closed out its half-hour nightly news show with a four-minute story on the band, describing them as, quote, "the hottest musical group in Britain," end quote, and also reporting that they may soon be bringing their sound to America. A report by Alan Kendrick on the Beatles was scheduled to air on the evening news with Walter Cronkite on the evening of November 22nd, in fact, obviously, this was preempted by other news. That piece was later aired on December 10th on CBS, prompting the first wave of demands for American disc jockeys to play the Beatles on their shows. In fact, it seems more likely that the assassination of JFK may actually have delayed the onset of American Beatlemania rather than fueled it. So, where does this idea come from that Beatlemania was made possible by the shooting in Dealey Plaza? Well, perhaps there is some truth to the Lester Bangs statement that the joyous energy of I Want to Hold Your Hand, quote, "lifted America out of its gloom, following which, high on gratitude, the country cast itself at the Beatles' feet." Of course, Bangs' other statement that, quote, "it was no accident that the Beatles had their overwhelmingly successful Ed Sullivan Show debut shortly after JFK was shot," end quote, is a bit more suspect, since none of the other musical historians seems to think there's any significant connection between the two events. In Mark Lewison's own words, the coincidence only became apparent with hindsight. But the truth is that the JFK assassination did indelibly change American media culture, even if it wasn't responsible for the fame of the Beatles. In an article for Reuters in 2013, John Herskovitz wrote that 6 seconds in Dallas 50 years ago changed the way media worked for decades to come. I'm willing to bet that for most of you watching this, not having access to 24/7 news coverage is nearly unthinkable. But in 1963, despite the growing popularity of television as a medium for entertainment, most people still got their news from newspapers and radios. That would be utterly changed by the days following the shootings in Dallas. Major television networks aired non-stop live coverage, even suspending commercials for the duration. An entirely new form of broadcasting the news, live from the scene, was being attempted for the first time, out of necessity as the country was desperate for information in the wake of the assassination. The very setting we associate with news broadcasts, the newsroom, was a decision made by Walter Cronkite and CBS while reporting on JFK's death. Jack Ruby was shot live on television with millions of people watching. This was an unprecedented series of events. The senior manager at the Newseum, Patty Rule, says that this was the moment when America became a TV nation. The ratings agency Nielsen reported one of the highest TV ratings in U.S. history during the televised procession to Arlington Cemetery for Kennedy's funeral on November 25, 1963. That President Kennedy's death should have had such a lasting impact on the relationship that Americans have with television and the news seems almost fitting, since Kennedy is considered to be the first television president. As you will remember, the Kennedy-Nixon presidential debates in 1960 were the first to be televised, and while there is some debate on the accuracy of the data, it's long been a popular belief that Nixon won the first of the 1960 presidential debates among the radio audience, while Kennedy was the winner when television viewers are the ones consulted. The Kennedy campaign used television campaign ads liberally throughout the election and courted celebrity endorsements from names like Judy Garland, Henry Fonda, and Frank Sinatra, among others. Even after he had won the election, Kennedy continued to change the way the presidency communicated with the public. Much like President Roosevelt's fireside chats of the 1930s, where he directly engaged with the public through radio broadcast, Kennedy brought the television cameras into the White House and became the first president to conduct live televised press conferences. And American media would be forever shaped by the events in Dallas in other ways as well. JFK's assassination would become a major focal point for film, television, books, music, and even video games. JFK, Ruby and Oswald, Interview with the Assassin, Ruby, The Kennedys, and Parkland are all movies or miniseries based on or around the shootings of the 35th President of the United States. Thousands of results are returned on Amazon when you search for Kennedy assassination. The event rates a mention in the Rolling Stones' 1968 song Sympathy for the Devil, Billy Joel's 1989 release We Didn't Start the Fire, and the music video for Lana Del Rey's 2012 national anthem reenacts the assassination. Gene Roddenberry desperately wanted to make a Star Trek film that would feature the assassination. Harvey Bennett, executive producer and writer on several of these Star Trek films, said that, quote, "Throughout my tenure on Star Trek, that story came up four times as a substitute for whatever we were planning. Star Trek 2, 3, 4, 5, it didn't matter," end quote. Supposedly, the climax of the pitched film would have featured Spock as the shooter on the grassy knoll. While Roddenberry never got his Kirk meets JFK time travel film, fiction films and entertainment from 2009's Watchmen and 2014's X-Men Days of Future Past to X-Files and Bones and Quantum Leap naturally have used the assassination as minor or major plot points because of the enduring interest in the events that even 60 years has not dulled. Much of what we take for granted from political campaigning to 24-hour news coverage and live reporting, and a great deal of the popular culture we consume today, is due to the life and death of Kennedy, be it strategically or tragically, except Beatlemania. We can't actually blame JFK for that one. We do hope you've enjoyed this episode, so to ensure you don't miss any of our future work, please be sure to press the like and subscribe button, and even more importantly, press the bell button before it is gunned down live on television in front of millions. Please consider supporting us on Patreon at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. And as we talk about the Cold War, please remember that history is shades of gray and rarely black and white.